Let me introduce you to Baron Simon de Pury. And Baron Simon de Pury is a famous auctioneer, art dealer, curator, collector, DJ, photographer. My first question, how can you do that, you know, all the above, how you manage to do that?
Well, it's just that I've been around for quite some time. Oh. So I guess when you get older, that's one of the advantages. It's like a cat of nine lives and you keep having to reinvent yourself. And I love art and you can approach it from every different angle. So I do try and do that.
Oh, that's fine. Well, I'd like to thank you for being with us because I know that a few months ago we met and I asked you if you would be interested in you know, being part of this Monaco Power of Positive Impact Summit, and you said yes, and talking about art, because art has also, I mean, it's also a fantastic power of positive impact, and your topic would be, you said the art of investing art in art during COVID times. So so maybe you could elaborate about that. And then I know that you've got some photos here. And then once we're done, we got about 20 minutes. We will have some questions, and I have some questions on my side as well. But please, the floor is yours, and we cannot wait to find out about investing in art.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me, and I'm thrilled to live in Monaco since a year and a half. In fact, I started my career in Monaco way back in the mid-70s when Sotheby's was organizing big auctions in Monaco, and I'm thrilled to be back in the Principality, and it's very, very exciting. Now, you've asked me to speak about the criteria to invest in art, and because very often people who love art, it's a very emotional thing. You react with your guts, with your heart. Right. And so often very Cartesian people tell me, well, this is great, but it's not with emotions that you can do good investments. And in fact, there are a lot of points that you can check off a checklist, which all contribute to give a financial value to an artwork. And I would like to just very rapidly lead you through some of these points to show you that it's not completely emotional, that if you do it rigorously, you can do a brilliant investment. So the first point, and we have the screen here, it says quality. All artists have good days and bad days, and it's better to buy a good artist on a good day than a good artist on a bad day. Here on the screen, we have the masterwork by Renoir. It was a boating party, which is hanging at the Phillips Collection in Washington, D.C. It was done in 1881. It's priceless. You can't say what it would be worth today. In 1990, a similar painting was sold for $78 million, which was a huge price back then. And I'd like to show you the next slide, which is a work done by Renoir on a bad day. I mean, you can see this is a little landscape study. It's very fuzzy. It's very cottony. This work here was sold quite recently at Sotheby's in London for £30,000. So it shows you the huge price difference you can have. And so therefore, don't buy with your ears, buy with your eyes. Next point, if I can see that, is authenticity. Of course, you have to make sure that what you look at is really what it is supposed to be. Can we see the next slide? Here we see one of the top masterworks by Basquiat, and in middle of the COVID crisis, we've heard of a Basquiat selling privately for $135 million. This is a work that is hanging at the Broad Foundation in Los Angeles. This would probably pulverize every record. And next slide, please. Here we see now, if we see the next slide, yes, here we are. This is a fake Basquiat. So if you buy a fake, well, it's worth zero, zero, zero. So this is a work, you should not touch it. I don't even want you to have to look at it any longer. And we move to the next slide, please, which is conservation. Can we see the next image? The conservation is a very important factor. Here we see an old master painting. On the left hand, we see how it looked in its unrestored state. On the right hand side, we see how it is when it was restored. So it was in pretty rotten state. And And so don't trust just your naked eye. Do ask a professional conservator to do a conservation report so that you know exactly what happened to the painting that you're interested in and what at which stage. Next slide, please. Size. Does size matter? That's the eternal debate. Well, maybe in the art world it's a little different. You don't want something that is too large. Let's look at the next painting. This is an exhibition that took place 3 years ago in San Francisco of XXX extra large paintings. And you see Julian Schnabel, who's a wonderful artist, standing next to the now the director of the Metropolitan Museum in New York. And you see the painting is so large that even the beautiful Légion d'Honneur Museum in San Francisco is too small to, you know, accommodate this painting. So if you'd like to sell it, it's tough, because who has a home that can accommodate such a work? Next slide. Now, every rule has an exception. Last month, in Dubai, there is a gentleman called Sacha Jaffry who's created the largest work in the world. He did it so that he could get into the Guinness Book of Records. And there is a Frenchman living in Dubai who has a cryptocurrency business who bought this for $62 million, making Sacha Jaffry the second most expensive painter in the world, which is no small achievement. Now, the Frenchman who bought this work said he's going to do a museum in Dubai. And so, you see, I said size did not matter, but maybe it could after all. Next slide, please. Rarity. It's very important that the work is neither too rare nor too prolific. So, can we have the next image? This is a work by Lucian Freud. Lucian Freud is one of my favorite artists, was a grandson of Sigmund Freud. Now, how do you know if an artist, while he's alive, is he prolific or not? The way to judge is how fast do they work? Lucian Freud was quite slow. So this is a work hanging in the Thyssen collection in Madrid. This was a lady with whom Lucian Freud had an affair, but he was so slow as an artist that, you know, the time it took him to finish the work, the affair was over, so he never managed to finish the work. So the two most valuable artists year after year are Picasso and Warhol, when you add up all the transactions on the market. One good reason is also, besides their absolute geniuses, that there are enough works by Warhol, there are enough works by Picasso to feed a steady market. If it's too rare, forget it.